I'm touching the other one of them too, McKay. You can just deal with it. Here,
I'll get that one.
I had a fan that went in there and cut like a cut. Yeah, and I went, did you get the birthday brownies? Well, we still put a note on them. I swear if I cook something, he'll smell it from the truck. I'm not kidding. He drives up. He can find that food just like that.
He rides around with his dogs and he learns how to sniff like that.
He went to take a bite of chicken and got 2 buckets of chicken for buckets.
Dang.
Crazy. Anyone?
Speaking of chicken, mm-hmm. I was craving chicken strips. Now, I try not to eat fried food, but I went to Chicken Express and got chicken, biscuit, and french fries with gravy.
Mm. Uh-huh. We did good.
Like comfort food. It's like something's wrong with me.
Unless
it's good food. Because in college we eat there all the time, but in college you can eat whatever you want.
Sydney was sick, like Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Their chicken strips are so good. But then I had the dirty food hangover like an hour later. You know what I mean? Where you feel like that's why I can't eat hardly at McDonald's, because I'll eat chicken nuggets and an hour later I have a McDonald's hangover.
Yeah, well, I saw those chicken nuggets on Facebook.
Like, do you really feel bad?
Yes!
Really?
Well, because it's really greasy.
Yeah, and you don't eat it all the time. That's why. I don't know. We were raised on grease and fried.
I mean, I get some, but like, you know.
Well, we don't do it as much as we used to because I just don't cook like that. Yeah. Anymore,
we didn't have a fried meat, we had fried potatoes.
Mm-hmm.
Or fried okra.
Well,
you know, we
had
fried
everything.
Yeah.
Mm. Good brownies.
Thank you. Eat them up, please.
So I decided next month, I worked on the schedule last month. I mean, I worked on the schedule yesterday for upcoming month. And I'm working here the 26th. I think we're going to open. So I know people may be out of town, but I know there might be people that want to come in. I've noticed during holidays, more people show up. Yes, and people are off work, like Chrissy.
Right. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
She's fun too.
And so I know I'm going to be here. So whoever, I understand if people are going to be out of town, but I also know some people can come. Yes, which is kind of an odd day to. And I don't know if the restaurant's going to be open the second, but if it's closed, I don't know. We'll just see.
If it changes closer to
but I know January I'll be doing 31-day challenge every day. So January is pretty busy for me. I'm excited about January.
Yeah.
To have a group going through the devotional. So I haven't
done
that before.
Not do it live every day?
No. What I do is I pre-record, because the book has 5 sections. And so when you get to a new section, I email the participants like a 5-minute video about the section. So that's only about once a week. So it'd be fun. It'd be good. Beverly said she couldn't make it today.
Grace just got her school picture.
My art for babies. Beverly.
No, she said she's not feeling well.
Uh-huh.
So
her allergies are doing bad.
Yeah, that's
and they've been
said.
That wind's been bad and getting to people. Maybe that's
right.
We better pray for it, David. Okay.
Probably would. Okay. Okay.
So all of us couldn't have any of that.
I know it's terrible, isn't it? Oh
no,
my God.
No.
Oh. So today we're talking about Malachi chapter 3, which I'm going to read chapter 4 too because it's only a few verses, but it's about giving, you know, about tithing, and also it's about, you know, not just doing rituals, but doing things from the heart. And so today is that principle of giving, and it comes back to you. And so I think we've all seen this at work before, you know, when you sow and then it comes back. So Jesus says in Luke 6:38, give and it will be given to you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. So he's talking about generosity here and having a giving heart. Which, you know, it's an appropriate also this time of year, you know, Christmas, you're giving gifts, you're giving to charity or whatever. And so, y'all have any thoughts on this verse? It's kind of counterintuitive, because the idea, if you give some of your resources, that you have less, right? But God says he will reward you and it will find its way back to you. So, and it means not just money, but it could also be giving your time to someone in need, or your advice, your wisdom, mentoring, or whatever. It comes back to you.
Sometimes I think that's better than money, that somebody will listen to you.
Right.
Because sometimes you can just say, hey, I don't have money, and if, right, you know, they'll just listen to you, or
right,
somebody that's wild, not God, they're obviously.
Right. Right.
Could help them more than.
Right.
But you're giving, if you are giving, there's a gift to you back.
Right.
I mean, you know.
Right. It's kind of that idea of you reap what you sow. So if you're sowing into people, it's going to come back to you. Or even a ministry or even a business. But then you drove off. But you did go get a brownie.
I had to
so.
Go. No, yes. Oh, yes.
Oh, it was already in your car. Never mind.
Yes, it was.
Cancel.
I can't lie. It was already. That's not why I left.
It's like, oh, yes, but it's not.
Mm-hmm. Gosh, it's really good.
Pass one?
No, I never have. Anyway, what part of elementary school do you wish you could incorporate into your adult life? And it even says, i.e. nap time. So it even gives an example. And mine would be nap time. And then I also thought of, I remember in elementary school, like, if you did well on your test or good behavior or whatever, you got to get certain candies out of certain jars, and like the candy got better with the bigger jars, and so like the ultimate was the sucker with gum in the middle, purple. Like, I wish I could incorporate that in my life. Whenever I make it, do something good, I get candy.
I think you did.
Yeah, right.
Oh, I was just always into recess and PE.
I think from a, like, something that I really can't do is, like, the ability to, like, go through the lunch line and just eat all you want and come home and eat all you want and
right,
never have any
right
repercussions from just eating. Like,
right.
So
basically a high metabolism.
Yeah.
Basically.
Yeah.
Incorporated the metabolism in your adult life.
But brownie and, you know, and a pan. I used to, I could eat a pan of brownies and
lose
a pound, you know.
Yeah.
Maybe that's not.
That's where that activity I'm talking about.
Oh,
was
Ann. Oh, the playground playing in the gym. Yeah. Oh, that's it. I want to work today. He was so big.
Yeah, they have too many.
So much fun.
Yep, too many video games, iPads.
We were playing sports.
Outdoors.
On the roof. We had horses. We saddled the horses some days and not come home till.
But now you can't just let your kids run out and do whatever they want. There's too many crazies.
No, it's so sad.
It is.
They're missing so much. Yeah. So sad. Mm-hmm. And you could tell.
A mile or half a mile, but 7? God, that's like a mini marathon. I mean, that's a little too hardcore. Week, Chrissy said this is her favorite part of Bible study. Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
How about that?
That was an awesome testimony about getting to, you know, leave those kids.
Oh, I know.
That was.
Oof. Yeah. Yeah, she does. Okay, we ready? As we plant our seed in faith, we trust the word of God and believe that when we sow to the Spirit, we will reap from the Spirit. We sow our seed in faith, believing for the spiritual and natural fruit of increase and multiplication. Jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, new business and accounts, favorable settlements, estates and inheritances, interests and income, finding money, debts paid off, forgiven, open doors, gifts and surprises, favor and increase, expenses decreased, money to sow and give, salvation of loved ones, restoration and healing, heaven opened, breakthrough and miracles, citywide harvest, order and alignment.
Yeah.
We could probably just go through every week and find some of this, you know, like, we got some people want to come to the farm. I mean, that's okay.
Yeah.
I
guess
those people can't
tell me. I've seen that before. I don't know what that was.
Ouch. Gosh.
And he wasn't even like riding it, he was just moving it out of the shop, and he's been moving around there. And maybe, I guess it hadn't started, and so he was trying to get it to go, and then he
went to
the He wasn't even out like being like for a while, or anything. He was literally just moving.
Right.
I've seen that same thing, he was being off.
Just like,
I saw it a long time ago. Okay. And there's a book. Yeah, it's really good.
Yeah, the book's great. And
I think
his dad was great, and his mom was very, very grateful people. And yet, when he started telling them
and
stuff, they couldn't believe it.
Right.
You know, and I thought, somebody that's extremely faithful can't even process.
Right.
You know. I mean, what they knew, I mean, he was a preacher. He knew that he had preached about heaven. But yet, when he started telling him actual things that happened, he couldn't believe. They didn't believe him. And when they started believing him, other people didn't believe him. And it's somebody's not a believer at all.
Well, then that's
pointless,
anything.
Right.
Yeah. I have some understanding going that way, not this way, because look at the alternative. I mean, it's
right.
I'd rather be wrong here,
and
take a chance.
Yeah.
I don't understand.
But
I
don't
believe that.
The stuff that happened, I don't know if you remember it at all, but like, he met his sister that died before she was born, and he did not know it at all.
Right.
You know, stuff like that.
Right.
Just, like, brings tears to
far
you.
Far out. Yeah. Well, and I think it's not proof, but a testimony to how real the spiritual realm really is. Spiritual realm is not the logic realm. You know, the logic realm says when you hold a paperclip, drop it, it falls to the floor and you can see it. Spiritual realm is unseen. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, that's kind of...
But, like, what I was getting from him is, like, it's almost easier to be faithful just by what we do in the Bible and what we have in faith, and to actually see it. You gotta preach it out to actually see it. You know, it's easier to go, I believe it, and I'm gonna go ahead and all that. But then when somebody just tells you and they mean it, it's right above that. And this little boy, I believe it. Some reason he knew it was shown to him. But you get a chance to
see
it.
Those people though that said they die and miss some hell too. They actually see that in other descriptions of it or less.
Right.
Like it couldn't have been almost.
Right, sure.
So it's something that I could never think of.
Right.
You know, just maybe 2 hours ago, but they weren't there. So
right.
I think that it would have been both ways.
But I mean, I've seen it big things over the years. It's just—it's almost better when you see something again. You know, I guess you kind of know what's going to happen for you with
any details.
Right. Probably in a study like we're doing now and everything. Right. You're probably getting more things up too.
Yeah. Right.
I'm glad I could sleep my I'm really glad I watched it again.
Has the very last chapter in the Old Testament. So. And then Jesus comes and it's a new world, new covenant. Okay. I'm going to pray real quick. Okay. Father God, I thank you so much for this morning, and I thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing in our lives, even in the midst of hustle and bustle, even just the daily concerns and stresses of life, Lord. I pray, Lord, that as we study Malachi, that you'd open up our hearts to receive what you want us to see, and that your spirit would reveal things to us, Lord. And I thank you for Becky. I pray she has a blessed birthday, God. We're just so grateful for Becky and how she contributes to this Bible study. And it makes our lives better, too. So, Father, you say that as iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. And that's why we meet, Father, to sharpen one another and to grow stronger in faith. And really, that helps us to have a more meaningful and blessed life by having each other meeting every week. So I just thank you for Becky. Thank you for Cheryl. And I just thank you for everyone who couldn't be here, Father, that you would bless them and be with them, Father. And so I just pray, Father, that you would just highlight things in our hearts as we read Malachi 3 in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, Malachi chapter 3. Okay, so Malachi in the Old Testament is a prophet, a Jewish prophet, and you know, Jesus talks about, when we read in the New Testament, he says, you hear him say the law and the prophets. The law is the first five books of the Bible, the do's and don'ts, the da-da-da. And then the prophets is the majority of the rest of the Old Testament. You have what they call the major prophets and the minor prophets. It's not because one's more important than the other. It's talking about the length of the books. Like Isaiah and Jeremiah are really long books, so they're major prophets. Malachi's the last of 12 minor prophets. So all these little books you see towards the end of the Old Testament are minor prophets. And Malachi is in those group of 12. And as we read, you'll see Malachi is setting the stage for the Messiah to come. Okay? And you'll see some things that kind of jump out at you that we've read in the New Testament. You'll go, huh, kind of correlates. So get over here. And Malachi is prophesying. He's pointing out the sins of the priests and the Levites. The Levites were the tribe set apart to do the temple service, sacrifices, praying for the people, making atonement for sin. So the Levites, the tribe of Levi, didn't inherit any land. There were 12 tribes, and they all split up the land. And I don't know if we've talked about this. Joseph had two sons, and they call it the half tribe of Ephraim and Manasseh. So Ephraim and Manasseh both got land, but the Levites did not. Instead, the Levites are scattered throughout all the territories in Israel, and that's where people would go to make sacrifices, to make vows to the Lord, and that sort of thing, religious ceremony and that sort of stuff. And Jerusalem was the holy city where they built the temple. But anyway, the Malachi, he's talking about the Levites, he's talking about the priests, and he's getting on to them because they're going through rituals, but their hearts aren't right with God. Okay? And so the way this applies to our life today, and I've read this about five times this morning, I kid you not, it talks about how we all are, as Christians, a royal priesthood. And a priest is basically someone who serves God. So if you're a Christian, you are, and it's weird to think this way, you're a priest to God. You know, you don't think of that, right? But you are. You're a royal priesthood. So in a way, if you think about it, when it says Levite, you can think of yourself. Because in a way, through Christ, we are his priests. We serve him. You know, and I know there's priests in the church and that sort of thing. It's not what I'm talking about. But it does say that we are a royal priesthood, meaning we are set apart from the world to do good works for God. And that applies to every Christian. It's not necessarily an office. So when you read the word Levite, you can think it applies to anyone who's a believer. Okay? So Malachi chapter 3. So Malachi's prophesying to the people. Behold, I'm going to send my messenger, and he will clear the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, and the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. Now, I'm pretty sure we just read this, but do you know who he's going to send my messenger, who he's referring to in the New Testament? He's talking about John the Baptist. Yep. John the Baptist is the fulfillment of this prophetic word by Malachi. It's so fascinating. So John the Baptist was born right before Jesus, and he said he came and started baptizing people, saying, repent, the kingdom. And then Jesus comes along and says, behold, the Son of God. So he is the messenger that God sent. And Jesus even says, John the Baptist is the greatest of men up till now. So he is the messenger that God is sending. Okay? Verse 2. But who can endure the day of his coming? And they're referring to the Messiah, right? And who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. So he's going to cleanse things. He will sit as a smelter and purifier of silver. And he will purify the sons of Levi. That applies to all of us. Okay? And refine them like gold and silver, so that they may present to the Lord offerings in righteousness. And that's what makes us, quote unquote, priests, is offerings. And it's talking about our works, the things we do in our life. Okay? Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord as in the days of old and as in former years. Then I will draw near to you for judgment, and I will be a swift witness against the sorcerers and against the adulterers and against those who swear falsely and against those who oppress the wage earner and his wages, the widow and the orphan, and those who turn aside the alien and do not fear me, says the Lord of hosts. For I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore, you, O sons of Jacob, are not consumed. From the days of your father, you have turned aside from my statutes and have not kept them. Return to me, and I'll return to you, says the Lord of hosts. But you say, how shall we return? So they're in trouble. Remember how I talked about they've been exiled to Babylon? They've done all these horrible things. They're serving false gods. I talked about, and this is horrible, throwing their little babies in fire. And this is interesting, because I was going to talk about this last week. The word hell that we read last week, I looked at the translation in Greek. It means Gehenna. And Gehenna is a valley in Israel where that's where they lit the fire and threw the babies into. So hell is referred to. I know it's disgusting, but I think we need to understand just how disgusting things are. Because then you would say, well, God, that doesn't seem very merciful of you. But when you see what they're doing, it's like smack them, you know? So anyway, but I'm just throwing a lot of stuff out here because it's all fascinating, right? Okay, so the Lord is basically making his argument with his people. But you say, how shall we return to you, Lord? Verse 8. Will a man rob God? Yet you are robbing me, but you say, how have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you are robbing me, the whole nation of you. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, so that there may be food in my house. And test me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven, and pour out for you a blessing until it overflows. Then I will rebuke the devourer for you, so that it will not destroy the fruits of the ground, nor will your vine in the field cast its grapes, says the Lord of hosts. All the nations will call you blessed, for you shall be a delightful land, says the Lord of hosts. And we've talked about that, rebuking the devourer. So So I know we've read this before. Okay, verse 13. Your words have been arrogant against me, says the Lord. And when I read that, I was reading this last night, I thought, if you listen to what people are saying today, look how arrogant they are against the word of God. It's the pride of man. When you quote scripture and people blast you and are arrogant, and I mean, we see it, right? It's the arrogance of men. So this still speaks today, even though it's Old Testament. Okay? Your words have been arrogant against me, says the Lord. Yet you say, what have we spoken against you? You have said, it is vain to serve God. And what profit is it that we have kept his charge and that we have walked in mourning before the Lord of hosts? So now we call the arrogant blessed. Not only are the doers of wickedness built up, but they also test God and escape. Then those who feared and revered the Lord spoke to one another, and the Lord gave attention and heard it. And a book of remembrance was written before him for those who fear the Lord and who esteem his name. And so, you may not realize this, but God has a book of remembrance for each and every one of us that serve him. Isn't that crazy to think? He's writing things about us because he loves us. So those who love God, he's remembering our good deeds. And he's blotting out our transgressions, our sins. Isn't that what? Right. Right. Yeah. And that's the gospel. That is the good news. It's very good news. Because we deserve death. We deserve punishment. We deserve hell. We all do. When you compare to God's perfection. Right. And that should humble us. So, okay. But it's cool to think a book of remembrance is written before God for those who fear the Lord and esteem his name. Okay, verse 17. They will be mine, says the Lord of hosts, on the day that I prepare my own possession, and I will spare them as a man spares his own son who serves him. So you will again distinguish between the righteous and the wicked, between one who serves God and one who does not serve him. So God is, you're either with him or against him. There's no yes, no yes, no maybe. It's one or the other. And I think as time will go on, it'll become more clear. It'll just become, Christians will seem more radical. The world will get more, I think it's worse now than it's ever been. And I think as time goes on, it will continue to. Right. But the good thing of that is, if you think about it, the darker it gets, when you light a light, the light's even brighter. So Christians will really shine. Right.
I like it when it says, test me. And I'll, you know, do what I ask and I'll bless you and everything will come together for you.
Right.
That's great there. Mm-hmm. I love when God takes heaven and pour out so much blessings to everyone.
Got it.
Yeah.
Overflow.
It's the same right there.
Right.
That's all you have to do.
Right. And I know there's a lot of issues within every church, and the church is certainly not perfect. But I think the churches, and if you look around the country, the churches are like a pillar in communities. And they really do operate in overflow, even with, you know, their scandals and stuff. But if you think about the churches here and just different places, look what a blessing in general churches are to a community. They feed the poor, they have food banks, they do clothing. It's like overflow. And so, you know, it really is true when God's people give the tenth of their income and time and resources, that God does bless that. You know what I mean? So, yeah. And a lot of, like, I've been to a lot of churches, they'll quote Malachi 3:10 before, like, doing the tithe and offering, bring the tenth, bring the tithe, help them. And that's kind of how God supports. It's not that God needs it, but it's kind of a test of we honor him with our resources, the tenth and the 90% is yours. And, but that's kind of how we fund the churches and the you know, but now does that get abused? Absolutely. Absolutely. But it doesn't negate the call of the time. So, anyway. But, yeah. And two, the tithe and offering is a very, I think it's very personal because nobody can tell you how much to give or not give. That's between you and God. Like, you know what I mean? So, I mean, that's, yeah. Nobody can, I mean, I watched Robin Hood the movie last night, and it's, the corruption of the church is horrible, and of course it's a story, but the church was like exploiting the people, and it's an extreme in Robin Hood the movie, but they're pulling the money out of the people for the church to fund the wars and the crusades and all that, and that was corrupt, but anyways, it was abusing their power.
Right. Yeah.
Right. But anyway.
And that's just the human part of the equation.
Right. They were forcing people to give.
Yeah.
That's what I was getting at.
Right.
And you can't do that. I would say.
I mean, say cancer research, or
right.
You know, is that not a?
I think it has to be. I think it has to do with conviction and how you feel led. So.
I think it ought to be.
The 10%, something that builds God's kingdom in some way. The church or the kingdom, or,
I
think that's.
At the time, the church is where the only way.
It's something to pray about. The Lord will show you. Like I said, that's why I say tithe and offering is kind of like obviously the 10%, but the offering and that sort of thing, it's like only you can make that decision, you know, between you and God. So, like I said, that's why I say kind of a personal thing because it's kind of based on your heart and your conviction of whatever you feel like. Yeah, the Lord, ask the Lord to show you. Right. That's why he asked the Lord to show you. And he will. So. And I love this verse 2, for he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. And if you think of like metal or gold, when it goes through the heat, all the impure stuff burns off and it becomes pure. And it's Jesus is the one who purifies us. And that's why we can't fix ourselves. You know what I mean? Like, Like, we can try to quote unquote clean up our act and make better decisions, but ultimately it's Christ's Spirit that is doing the cleaning. You can't self-clean. You can make good decisions and move towards God, but ultimately He is the refiner's fire and the fuller's soap. So I just really like that, because to me it's almost relieving, because I know my mistakes, my past failures, my sins, my shortcomings, my whatever, and I can't clean myself. I can try to do better, but my identity is in Him and what He can do, you know? And I think that offers a lot of hope to people that, a lot of hope to people that already know they're messed up. I just really like that verse. It's very, the imagery. And, it says in the New Testament, by grace you've been saved, by faith, not works, so that no one can boast. It's like, it takes the pressure off because it's by faith. You just have to believe. You know? You don't have to. You don't have to tithe, you know what I mean? You don't have to do anything. You just have to believe Him. And then He goes to work. And today I listened to a chapter a day in the New Testament coming to work. And today I heard how Jesus is talking in parables, illustrations. And He says, what can I compare the kingdom of God to? And He says, it's like a man who puts a seed in the soil, and then it grows up, and then it, you know, and then the stem, the leaves, and then the head, and then they come and harvest it. And it, for some reason, it was so relieving, because it's like, when you believe, that's like, you're not doing anything, you're just believing. And the moment you believe, it's like the seed is in the soil, and you don't say, okay, grow. It just naturally does it. And so when we believe, or we come to Bible study, we read a verse and it pops out to us, it starts to grow on its own. You don't make it happen. I don't make it happen. He does. And that takes the pressure off, don't you think? You know what I mean? Like, you can't force yourself to be godly. He makes you godly. And you see that in people that were wild as crazy. And then you see them turn around, and they're not perfect, but you can tell a huge difference. And you know it was something supernatural or an act of God, because they're a different person. And they didn't do that, did they? They just believed and it changed their life. I don't know, it's just, anyway. To me, it takes the pressure off. Because I like to work, 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 you gotta earn it, you gotta earn it, you gotta earn it. It's like, no, you can't earn that. And if you think about, we were talking about the church and seeing abuse, that's what they were seeing right here. Because He says in verse 5, I will draw near to you for judgment, and I will be a swift witness against the sorcerers. And so sorcery was rampant, and it still is in our culture today. And I'll bring it up because it's truth. Harry Potter, it's childish, but there's some sorcery even in Harry Potter. Some different stuff. I mean, that is sort of witchcraft, sorcery, even if it's watered down, you know what I mean? And so they were using sorcery for supernatural power. They weren't relying on God, demonic stuff. And then it says, and against the adulterers and those who swear falsely, so lying. So the priests were lying. And against those who oppressed the wage earner and his wages. So if people did work for him and you didn't pay them, you know, that's wrong. And the widow and the orphan and those who turn aside the alien and do not fear me, says the Lord of hosts. So obviously he's addressing the priests, you know, and they had a lot of power, right? It's kind of a theocracy type, you know, the God of Israel. So the priests had a lot of political power too. And in the New Testament, the Pharisees, the Sadducees had tremendous political power. And they were the religious. So in today's world, some of these mega churches, and I'm not naming churches by name, but you see the abuse, and that's what y'all were just talking about. And that's why I think you can see when something's authentic, you know. And I don't think God expects you to blindly put your money into an offering if you know there's some huge issues. He may lead you to do something else or go somewhere else to get it. So. And another verse that pops out to me, so now we call the arrogant blessed. It's just an interesting statement. Isn't that bizarre? And what's interesting, this is the very last book of the Old Testament, so we have to think in terms of the Messiah is coming. So when Malachi prophesied, he was one of the last prophets, and then there's this pause for a few hundred years between the Old and New Testament, and silence. And then John the Baptist comes, and Jesus, and then boom, the church. And here we are still going. So.
Do you believe that?
There is the Apocrypha, which the word Apocrypha means doubtful. So.
Yeah.
But I think there are testaments, but I wouldn't consider it the quote-unquote holy canon. I mean, there's no, if you want to read it, fine, but I wouldn't treat it with the accuracy of the scriptures that we have. So that's how I'd answer that. Because you have like the Mac verses, I get Maccabees. Oh, there's certainly other literature, some of it, you know, but I wouldn't consider it necessarily the say of the Lord, this is 100%. So, anyway. But. I'm going to read chapter 4 real quick, because it's really short, okay? So, final admonition. For behold, the day is coming, burning like a furnace, and all the arrogant and every evildoer will be chafed. And the day that is coming will set them ablaze, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. But for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings, and you will go forth and skip about like calves from the stall. You will tread down the wicked, for they will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day which I am preparing, says the Lord of hosts. Remember the law of Moses, my servant, even the statutes and ordinances which I commanded him in Horeb for all Israel. Which we've read that. If you'll remember a long time ago, we read out of Leviticus, and it had the do's and don'ts. And anyways, he was at Horeb, so that's what he's referring to. For behold, I'm going to send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. Do y'all know who Elijah he is referring to? Okay, verse 5. Behold, I'm going to send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. Do you know who he's referencing? We've already said his name once.
Is that right?
Yes. So that's who the scripture is referring to. And that's why the Pharisees even asked Jesus about this, because they're referring to the scripture. Okay, verse 6. He will restore the hearts of the father to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, so that I will not come and smite the land with a curse. So, that one's short. Anyway. So, very messianic kind of the closure of the Old Testament. And then the New Covenant is coming. And next month, we're going to talk about the New Covenant. Actually, next week, we're going to talk about the New Covenant in Hebrews 8. And how we're no longer under the Old Testament. But everything that happens here is what led up to the New Testament and why God established a new covenant. So, any other thoughts? Cheryl.
And it's like what they pass.
Be happy.
You can see it.
Happy.
Yeah.
refers to it as the great and
dreadful day. And I've actually talked about this, and I think my Ortiz, I talk about, for those who believe, it'll be an awesome day. For those who've rejected him, it's terrible. So it's a two-edged thing.
Yeah. Right.
It's like
dreadful.
Right. Pretty wild. That's why it's such a serious thing and people are apathetic and they shouldn't be. It's an intense book, but it sets the stage for John the Baptist and Jesus and establishing the church and walking in a new and better covenant, which we're in right now. We're in a covenant of grace. So. Anyway. Yep. All right. Prayer requests, praise reports. Well, I already have 4 signups for 31 Day Challenge. So,
don't what?
31 Day Challenge. I have 4 people signed up. I usually try to send it like on Black Friday or right after Thanksgiving. And then once a week I send out, I do.
How was your book signing?
It's good. I had some people subscribe, and but I wish I had stayed up until the parade, but I had to be back over here. But hindsight, I would have just waited and come back late. That's not as covered for now. Maybe next year.
Yeah.
You know, but it was good. It was really good. She's recovering, so Beverly didn't know if she's going to be able to make it this week or not. She's recovering, so that's good.
Enjoy it more and realize more of what it's
about.
Yeah. Absolutely. Because it does get really hectic.
Right.
It's so stressful.
It does.
It's on edge and
this
time home, this time work, this time for, you know, kids in college, kind of things. Oh, so everything just goes crazy.
Right. It seems like the world spins faster.
Mm-hmm. It's a shame, too.
Rogers, Brent Reinhardt, his
Trisha's surgery, the kids in the library had a safe place, and the blessing and the disaster. Yep.
Can you see the page about the basketball team from California?
Mm-hmm.
And the girls, I mean, it was the Bayon Davis girls. And the other team that they're playing against provided uniforms and stuff because, you know, they lost everything. Mm-hmm. It said that in the school system, like only one, I think it's like one in maximum or something, somewhere around there, of the kids in the school had homes.
Gosh.
There's like 18 or 19 kids lost their home.
Lost it all away for a little bit, and then everybody goes like this.
Father God, thank you so much for the study today, and we just praise you, God, for another day, Lord, another opportunity to just live life for your glory, God. And Lord, help us remember life is short, so to just make moments count, Father. We could lose, when it's our time to go, it's our time to go, God, but when it's not our time to go, that means we still have purpose in this world. And so, Lord, I just pray, Lord, that we would keep all things in perspective, whatever we're dealing with. And Lord, I just praise you for the new sign-ups on 31-Day Challenge, already getting started early. And I just pray over that, Lord, that you would use it just as a tool to help people get on the right track with you, God, and to go deeper. And, Lord, I just lift up prayers for everyone, Father, that we'd keep peace during the holidays and just remember, Jesus, that you are the reason for this season. So help us to have peace even in the midst of the hustle and bustle. Pray for Harvey's son-in-law's family, the wife, Autumn, and the kids. How traumatic, Lord, to just no explanation, just to lose a husband, a friend, a father, a son-in-law. Lord, so I just pray for the family to comfort them in this just tragic time, Father, in the holidays. And Father, we pray for the families in California that have lost homes, Father, that you would be with them. And comfort them. And I pray it would unite people to help one another. And just even with the basketball team providing uniforms for the other team, God, how kind and gracious, Lord. So I just thank you for good works like that, Father, that just remind us that we're not alone, that there can be beauty even in tragedy. And so, Lord, I pray just a special blessing over everyone right now, Father, and the work you're doing each and every one of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay.